1988, the northeastern shopping chain Zayre officially filed for bankruptcy protection. Zayre was a large-scale but regionally local department store brand that sold a wide variety of items for discounted prices. They were similar in nature to store chains like Ames and Kmart. However, as the years progressed, the highly regarded and nostalgic business would eventually die out. But why? Why did Zayre collapse as the years passed? That's what we'll be diving into on tonight's episode of The Story Of.
If you think you know what Zayre is all about, take another look. It's a whole new store.
I can't get over the way it's changed.
It's a lot brighter.
More cheerful.
There's so much to choose from.
Everything's so nice.
I like the change. I really do.
There are so many lovely things.
Beautiful.
Really pretty clothes.
It really is a whole new store.
Beautiful. They sure made it look a lot nicer.
Beautiful.
I love it.
If you haven't seen Zayre lately, you haven't seen Zayre. Come on, take another look.
Get to Zayre.
Zayre's story starts in Boston, Massachusetts. In 1919, a store called the New England Trading Company was opened up by two Russian brothers, Max and Morris Feldberg. It started out as an underwear store, and 10 years down the line, the store was launched as a retail operation. It was initially called Bell Hosiery Shops, however, as time moved on, it was shortened to Bell Shops. A few years down the line, Bell Shops began to expand into other markets. They began selling women's specialty items, and by the end of World War II, there were over 30 Bell stores in the Northeast. In 1946, Bell Shops would buy Nugent's, a women's clothing store chain based in New York City. This gave them another 30 store locations, and this also allowed them to easily expand into new regions for marketing. As well as Bell Shops was doing, however, by the 50s, they were seeing some issues with their sales. Downtown business areas were beginning to decline around this time, meaning Bell Shops would have to make a big change if they were to continue succeeding in the market. What was becoming popular at that time, and thusly the main source of Bell's problems, were mill stores. These would be low-priced clothing stores started in old and empty textile mills, such as Ames, which I covered in the last episode. You can check it out in the card above. However, Bell ultimately ditched this idea and instead went with discounting their products as a method. Now, with the sons of the original owners, Stanley and Sumner Feldberg, in charge of the company, the decision was made to build a new and clean store in 1955, when a company named Stop & Shop Inc. offered to build a new store for Bell Shops next to a Stop & Shop market in Hyannis, Massachusetts. Then, only a year later, in 1956, the new store was opened. It was named Zayre by the brothers, which means very good in Yiddish. Zayre started in the Northeast, but over time expanded to the Midwest. 3 years down the line in 1959, there were around 6 Zayre stores open. However, by 1962, that number tripled. Zayre became a public company that same year also, meaning it was now trading on the NYSE. Zayre's initial growth was largely due to a Rhode Island-based advertising agency. In the early 60s, Zayre began mass opening stores, as I stated earlier. The company execs had a business direction where they would open up many stores in large clumps, thus growing their presence and maximizing their efficiency. This served the company well, as by 1966, Zayre had 92 stores going down across the US from the north to the deep south. In 1966, Zayre purchased the Towers Marts and Consumer Mart of America chains, both dying discount retailers. Down the line in 66, the company also purchased a chain called Northern Enterprises Inc., which owned a small chain called Shoppers City. Zayre's rebranded them as Zayre Shoppers City, which, while it's not a really interesting rebranding, I tend to see this method used quite often, where the new owners of a chain will sometimes keep the original name and just kind of throw on their own branding. I believe this might be due to customer loyalty, although that's just a theory. Shoppers City was especially interesting, however, as it was one of the first implementations of the hypermarket store design, which combined the idea of a supermarket and a department store. From my observations, hypermarket stores tend to be more popular in foreign markets, namely the Middle East, Europe, and South Asia, which would explain why I haven't really heard of them before. Zayre shifted its market over time from women's fashion in its early days to a much more standard and widespread discount selection of goods, things like toys, food, books, health products, and so forth. Almost a third of Zayre's revenue in its beginnings came from leased out departments. However, as the 60s progressed, Zayre would buy out many of the companies it once leased sections to. The 1970s didn't see too much action, but it did see one massive step forward.
TJ Maxx! Over 10,000 brand
new. Zayre moved to purchase the Marshalls chain, however that venture failed, so they took a different direction. Instead, the Zayre executives hired a previous merchandise manager for Marshalls and created a Marshalls clone known as TJ Maxx. The brand began to grow, becoming popular almost immediately. This eliminated the need to purchase Marshalls, as Zayre now had one of their own. Now we enter the 80s, an interesting period for Zayre. In 83, Zayre purchased an off-price fashion company named Chadwick's. The buy was a strange one, but it led Zayre to begin focusing more on its off-price goods. In early 1983, these sales made up 45% of Zayre's main income. In 84, a year later, Zayre started on a new large-scale warehouse brand, one resembling Costco, named BJ's Wholesale Club. It was a membership warehouse-style bulk store. Then, in 1985, Zayre purchased a home improvement chain named Home Club Inc. However, this and BJ's did not prove as profitable in the early run as TJ Maxx and their new Hit or Miss brand. Hit or Miss was acquired during the Chadwick's purchase. That same year, however, the streak of luck would come to an end when Zayre purchased the Gaylord's department store chain. This is essentially what ruined Zayre. This single buy would lead the brand to its shockingly quick failure down the line, which they would never recover from.
I like the way we're gonna make your day.
We'd like to make Zayre your store.
Zayre knows when you come in for an advertised item, you want to find that item. So we're gonna try to keep our shelves stocked.
Come along and say that Zayre.
If we have to give you a rain check, we'll give you an extra 10% off when you come in to pick it up.
We'd like to make Zayre your store.
They were all out, right?
Ta-da!
We'd like to make Zayre your store.
I just made Zayre my store.
The massive problem with the Gaylord's buy was really the manner in which it was conducted. The new stores that Zayre would open in that era were, to put it simply, messy. Zayre tried to make up for it via celebrity appearances and their grand openings for their new stores, however, this essentially did nothing and Zayre began to go down the drain. In 86, however, something was going well for Zayre, all thanks to their Hit or Miss brand. In that year, Hit or Miss sales had reached over $300 million. It was doing so well thanks to its business model, by having around 70% of their inventory be nationally known brands, and the other 30% being standard clothing produced by Hit or Miss, they could sell popular fashion products for significantly lower prices than your average store. However, that didn't change much. In 86, due to their slowly decaying Gaylord's purchase, Zayre's profits began dropping. Brands like Hit or Miss or TJ Maxx, whose main shopper demographic was richer folk, were doing very fine. In 1986, Zayre opened up over 35 TJ Maxx stores and 31 Hit or Misses. In 1987, TJX Companies became a subsidiary of Zayre. In early 1988, however, Zayre lost over $69 million worth of profit. The main cause behind the company's sharp economic decline was the lack of maintenance on their stores. Their technology was behind and lacked modernity. Their prices were just not good. And a name of low class and messiness began to overtake the once fancy Zayre brand. Zayre decided to work on TJ Maxx, however, seeing as they were doing significantly better as a subsidiary than Zayre itself. They decided, as a result, to begin mass selling off their Zayre department stores. That same year, Zayre filed for Chapter 11 bankruptcy protection, essentially spelling out the end of their brand. In late 1988, they sold almost 400 locations to Ames department stores. Zayre kept focusing on TJ Maxx, beginning to let go of their other spin-off brands. BJ's Wholesale Club and Home Club were both let go. That same year, 1989, Zayre merged entirely with TJX and changed their company name from Zayre to TJX Companies, Inc. Ames struggled greatly with the Zayre stores they received from the buy, which led to their demise in 1990. By that same year, all Zayre stores, stores belonging to America's once fifth largest retailer, were all gone. Zayre was essentially no more.
Now, even deeper discounts. 73 stores of Zayre's are going out of business and must liquidate millions of dollars of inventory. Save 25 to 50% and more on everything in every department. Not a clearance or odds and ends, not selected markdowns. Everything has original price tags. Cashiers deduct an additional 25%, even on items already reduced one quarter, one third, and one half. It's the Zayre sale you'll never forget. Nothing held back. Everything. Come in now. 73 stores of Zayre's are going out of business.
It was somewhat surprising to read Zayre's story. I didn't realize so many of the stores I've frequently shopped at in the past are all from this one company. Zayre had an effective business model going for them, but I think there's a really good lesson to take from this episode. Everyone has their limit, and this applies to companies as well. For a company like Zayre, what they did was clearly too ambitious for them. Their purchasing gaylords led to the company having too wide an overreach, and they clearly couldn't control or oversee everything. What was the limit for Zayre may have been significantly lower than the limit for other brands, say Walmart, Kmart, so on and so forth. However, it was a limit nonetheless, and it proved destructive when they overstepped it. As a result, the company just died out in a matter of only 5 years, the quickest fall of a chain I've ever seen. Maybe they should get a reward for that.